Morning, everybody. Let's try that again. Good morning, everybody. It's good to have everybody with us this morning. Thank God for you being here. Looking forward to seeing what God's got in store for the service this morning. Do not forget to pick up a calendar before you leave this morning. We do have the new calendars for November, kind of showing you what all is going on with the church this month. But if you will, stand to your feet and let's go. That was my message. But if you will, like I said, stand to your feet. Let's see what God's got in store for this morning's service. Come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of this water, come and thirst no more. Well, come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us his own. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world. Blessings flow. Praise him, praise him for the wonders of his love. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, for the wonders of his love. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. For Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world. Somebody praise the Lord.
arms alone now and forever. The love this world could never stop. There's no one like our God. Now to touch the broken. Mercy breaking through this moment. Faithful is the one who saves. Worthy is your name.
Oh God, the glory is yours. The kingdom is come and the battle is over. Jesus, in your name we rise, and the glory is yours. The glory is yours. Yours, the kingdom is come and the battle is over. Jesus, in your name we rise. The glory is yours, the glory is yours. Oh God, the glory is yours. The kingdom is come and the battle is over. Jesus, in your name we rise. The glory is yours, the glory is yours.
Nobody beside you, there has never been anyone, anything like you.
Nobody beside you, there has never been anyone, anything like you. Nobody beside you, there has never been anything, anything like you.
Oh God, the glory is yours, the kingdom is come, and the battle is over. Jesus, in your name we rise, and the glory is yours,
the glory is yours. Oh God, the glory is yours, the kingdom is come, and the battle is over.
Jesus, in your name we rise, and the glory is yours,
the glory is yours. Oh God, the glory is yours,
the kingdom is come, and the battle is over.
Jesus, in your name we rise, and the glory is yours, the glory is yours. Beside you, there has never been anyone, anything like you.
Nobody beside you,
there has never been anyone, anything like you.
Nobody beside you,
there has never been anyone, anything like you.
Nobody beside you,
there has never been anyone, anything like you.
Somebody praise the Lord. I told him that sounded like a Celtic song. I need a skirt. Come on, church, let's worship him this morning. Hallelujah. Has he been good to you?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, no, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh yeah. Oh, shame no longer has a place to hide.
See, church,
And I am not a captive to his lies. Oh, and I am not afraid to leave my past behind. No, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every chain. You see, church, there's power that can empty out of grave. And there's resurrection power that can save. See, there's power in your name. Oh, there's power in your name. You see, our fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand.
Madison, come on. Okay. They practice this thing.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? The shame's done all it's stealing. And you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Jesus, and how my Jesus changed your life. Hallelujah, hallelujah, amen. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh.
Sorry.
We did practice. I remember how you told me life might not be easy, and everything that I need you already give me. I remember how you told me I could trust you completely. So why am I doubting when you're proving that you fight for me? I can feel I can barely breathe. You walk through these fires, 'cause you're walking with me. Come on, church. I'm changed by your mercy. See, I'm covered by your peace. And I'm living out the victories. This doesn't mean that I won't feel the heat. See, church, you've walked me through fire. You hold me from flames. See, Lord, if you're in this with me, I won't be afraid. I mean, you know this, when the smoke billows higher, and it's higher, feels like that I can barely. Walk through these fires, 'cause you're walking with me. I can face anything, 'cause you're here with me. I can do all things, 'cause you strengthen me. Price of my redemption.
Go ahead. Thank you,
Lord. How can I question when you've proven that you die for me? You walk me through fire. Lord, you call me from flames. If you're storms of the light, when the smoke billows higher, Lord, and it's higher, feels like that I can barely breathe. I'll walk through these fires, 'cause you're walking with me. Oh, yes, I'm.
Everybody praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Part of the song where it says, I can do all things because you strengthen me. How many of you know when the storms of life and the flames of life billow higher and higher? How many of you have ever been to the point in your life where you felt like you could barely breathe? Where it seems like every time you take one step forward, the enemy throws you three steps back. But I don't know about you this morning, but no matter what the enemy throws against me, Scripture says, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Nothing is impossible with God. No matter what goes on in your life, you can do all things through Christ, which gives us your strength. You know, as I was praying, and I got a word of confirmation Wednesday night, there is so much I want to teach this church. And I feel like that every time I get to a point I think I'm comfortable with a series, the Lord changes it. And He can do that. He's God. So I'm going to encourage you to invite everybody you can from this point out. Because on Sunday mornings, I'm going to teach on what are the signs of His coming. And on Wednesday night, and I'm going to finish this out, we're going to start a teaching on the book of Revelation. I don't know about you, but I sense that the Holy Spirit is telling me the Lord's getting ready to come back. The Bible tells us in the hour that they think not, the Son of Man appeareth. And I was studying on that. That ain't talking about the sinners. That's talking about the church. The church ain't even expecting His appearing. The church lives like hell, but yet they call themselves holy. Come on, church. Glory to God. They have a form of godliness, and the Word of God even said that, but they deny the power. You know, I was thinking, there was a song back in the day, you know, an old song of the church, says, soon and very soon we are going to see the King. And as I've studied the Scripture, and I'm going to tell y'all something, I seen something again last night that just confirms that we're living in the soon coming of the Son of God. There was a commercial for this crypto and Bitcoin, and the slogan said, the money of the future. What does that tell us? How many of you know, I don't know about y'all, but maybe I'm the only one in the house. How many of you have ever felt guilty giving cash? Ever done that? Like you go into, it's like almost a shame to have cash in your pocket. Come on now. Like whenever you get, maybe you go through a drive-thru, or maybe you go into, how many of you have ever said, I'm sorry, this is all I got? At least you got something. But, you know, I was sitting there and I was thinking about this. And as the Holy Spirit started showing me on what God wanted me to teach. Yes, we are a church of restoration and second chances, but we need to be a church that's ready for the appearing of the Son of God. You know, I was thinking, I was talking to some folks this week, and it amazes me. And I say this, the Bible tells us that we shouldn't be a stumbling block to a person. We should live a life holy and acceptable and well-pleasing to God. But I'm going to tell you something I found out this week, and God just confirmed it more. That you want to do, you'll find a way to do it. If you want to go to church, there's more churches than just one. If you want to serve God and worship, there's churches like ours. I know of at least one just half a mile down the road, similar to our church. But people, here's the problem, and maybe I'm the only one, and this is just to be real in the grill and tell it like it is. Everybody wants the oil, but nobody wants to pay the price. You don't step into leadership of your company until you go through the faithfulness, the proper training, and everything it takes to get there. See, the one thing that God showed me, what are the signs of his coming, I told Brother Bo that I'm going to throw this scripture up quite a bit, probably for at least the first few months of this teaching, and then he's got some other things that we're going to talk about. In the book of 2 Timothy, and I want him to go ahead and go there. 2 Timothy 3:1 says this, "But know this," the Apostle Paul, the Apostle Paul was writing his second journal, if you will, to Timothy. He's talking to Timothy from prison. Two-thirds of the New Testament is written by the Apostle Paul, and most of it is written while he is handcuffed and shackled to a soldier. And the thing was, it doesn't tell you this in the Bible, but in the history of the Bible, now please listen to me. What we have here in these 66 books is just a synopsis of all the things that happened throughout biblical times. The Word of God even tells us that Jesus did so many miracles when he was walking on earth that there wasn't enough time to write it all down. So when people says, well, Jesus did this, 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 and this, folks, we have to stop being ignorant. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, when you read the scripture, it says the gospel according to. Oh, come on now. The gospel according to. The Apostle Paul, when he wrote the book of Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, we can go on and on and on. He was writing this from prison. See, isn't it funny that Genesis is the first book in the Bible, but Moses wrote the book? Moses didn't show up to the second book in the Bible, in the book of Exodus. What I want to do, what my job is as the pastor of this church, and all those that are watching on CORCC TV, it is my job. Yeah, I would love to shout and everybody stand up and hoop and holler and run around if that's what you want to do. But the thing is, that's not the season that we're in. We are in the season of the preparation of the soon coming of the Son of God. And we must understand today that these are the signs of his coming. He said, but know this, in the last days perilous, evil, wicked times will come. Now look at this. Verse number 2 says this. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, boy, ain't that the way it is today, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasures rather than lovers of God. My goodness, everything. Having a form of godliness but denying its power. In other words, folks, they say they're Christians but they live a different life outside the church. Glory to God, they claim to be a child of God, but they don't live it when they're away from the house of God. Everybody can be saved in the house of God, but it's the way you live outside the house of God that matters. Glory to God, it says, and from such people turn away. What do they turn away from? People who have a form of godliness. Look at this. For of this sort are those who creep into households and make captive of the gullible women, loaded down with sins, led away by various lusts. Always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of truth. Now, as Janus and Jambres resisted Moses, so do these also resist the truth, men of corrupt minds, disapproved concerning the faith. Look at verse number 9. But they will progress no further, but their folly will be manifest to all, as theirs also was. Now, catch this. When I was praying and seeking God about the signs of his coming, this word kept coming up when it says, men shall be lovers of themselves. And like I said, I want to teach. Here's what will separate people from the love of God. Self-centeredness. When you look at how many of you know self-centered people? And you know, the thing is, there's coming a time that these people that are self-centered, How many of you know people will leave churches of America if they're not the center of the attention? If it's not about them, they'll walk away until they find a place that it's about them. See, let me share some funny things with you. How many of you have ever heard the word selfie? Did you know the word selfie is 8 years old? Oh, I'm going to try to teach y'all here. As I was typing my notes this week, we officially live in a selfie culture. The word selfie did not come into existence. It made the Webster's Dictionary in 2013. How many people, don't need to take a selfie? But people take it all the time. Oh, I'm at church. Let me take one. Or they get in front of a mirror and they take pictures of themselves and you can't see their face, but you can see the camera. You know people like that. I think it's funny when people take selfies all the time. That's going to be called a wreck pretty soon. But think about this. The word selfie came into existence in the Oxford Dictionary. Think about that. And I think I need to say this again. You need to write this down. We officially live in a selfie culture. See, think about that. Let's marinate about that for a minute. A recent study showed, this is sad, a recent study showed half of Americans have snapped a selfie. Selfies have replaced dogs as man's best friend. Marinate on that for a minute. Selfies. I see people, honest to God, are they seeing what we see? I look pretty today, according to who? Who told you you look pretty? I'm just being honest. Have you ever seen somebody take a selfie and put it on Facebook and you look and you're like, do you see what? There was a time you didn't take a picture of ugly. Am I helping you? Think about what I'm saying. Okay, but we live in a selfie culture. I was sitting at a restaurant one day. Well, it was actually a couple of weeks ago. Well, good Lord, I better not say a couple of weeks ago. It was on my birthday week, and some of the folks at work took me out for lunch. And I was sitting at the restaurant, and I was just looking. No conversation amongst anybody in the restaurant. Everybody was on their cell phone. Sad thing is, let me tell you folks that stay on them and you're constantly doing this, when you get about 70, you're going to be doing just like this. Because your spine is going to be a curvature. Am I telling the truth of the way you stand? That's why you ever heard them say, stand with your shoulders back. But the thing is, we live in that culture. And selfies represent self-centeredness. Because I'm going to tell you something. If you and I are sitting and we're supposed to be conversating, and if I'm telling the truth or telling you, you can amen me, we're conversating and you see me texting on my phone, you're sitting there saying what's more important to you is yourself, not me. Self-centeredness. See, let me pretend, catch this. Let's not pretend that selfies are the new phenomenon. Photographers have snapped selfies for years. Let me see how it looks first. Today, rather than call it, catch this. But here's the kicker. Now catch what I'm getting ready to share with you. Social media, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat give selfies enormous popularity. From the jocks to the nerds, from the CEOs to the construction workers, Selfies are loved by almost everyone. And I don't care if you take selfies. I don't really look at Facebook and care what people put on there. I'm more concerned about putting, you don't want to miss what's going on at City of Refuge this morning. I'd care less if you take a selfie. But the thing is, we see people doing that. I mean, have you ever seen somebody take a selfie of themselves eating their food? Think about what I'm saying. They take a picture of their food. And the thing is, they go, good. No, you ain't even tasted it yet. There's people that will take Snapchats of waste that they put out. I'm not just being honest with you. There's people that take pictures of their poop and send it to people. But we live in that kind of society. But think about how selfish we've become. I'm trying to help y'all. Think about how selfish we've become. Our cell phone rings and the person that we're talking to is no longer important. It bothers me. I mean, when I see people, parents and their kids sitting at the dinner table and their children's on their cell phones. I seen the greatest commercial the other day. The family walked into the door and my grandma had a basket that said cell phones here. Come on. And they were like, what? She said, I'm taking up my cell phones. We're going to have it. We're going to sit at the dinner table and we're going to talk. Amen. Do you know that the dinner table, here's self-centeredness. When our children, we need to sit down with our kids at the dinner table and talk to them. Has anybody reached out to someone this week? We've had an 11-year-old girl get killed in a tragic automobile accident this week. We've had a teenager from Fort Bush High School get shot accidentally by a gun. We had a young man commit suicide 2 weeks ago, and we're wondering what's going on. We parents have become self-centered. We don't care about what goes on in our children's life anymore. We don't care. As long as we give them a cell phone, they'll leave us alone. As long as we give them, I know this is tight, but right. As long as we give them gas to put in their car, at least they're not bothering us. And we wonder why our youth are the way they are. Did not know this message was going this way, but it's the truth. Well, it'll be somebody else's problem. Did you know that the jails are full of young men and young women that wish mama and daddy would have talked to them and told them what was going on? We're self-centered. We are self-centered. I said, and when I talk, I'm not talking, if you're not, God bless you, but we have become self-centered. When you see a parent wearing better clothes than the children, when you see parents that will spend $100, $200 on their hair and tell their child, when you get old enough, I will do this. But we've become self-centered. See, the thing is this. While social media affords us opportunities never imagined before, these opportunities often come with a price. Come on, church. Slowly, we have become selfie-centered. And a selfie-centered Christian portrays a false picture of God. Selfie-centered. How many people do you know are selfie-centered? There is, the Bible said, in the last days did come a time they would not endure sound doctrine. That's today. When I sit and talk to pastors, and I have plenty of pastor friends I talk to throughout the week, and they're like, I really want to give my church a message that God has given me, but if I do, they might leave. Preach it. Because the Word of God said, don't quench the Holy Spirit. When I wanted to finish marriage, God told me I need to get to the individual. I need to make you understand that we are living in a selfie. I'm going to tell you something. There was a time children wasn't on their cell phones in church. And here's what our kids use as an excuse, because mine tried to use it on me. Well, Daddy, I'm looking at the Bible. We got it right here. We good. We got a bow. And you don't need to look up the scripture. He'll give it to you right here. Trust me, hit me this morning at 7 o'clock. Any scripture today? But there was a time. See, we come self-centered in church. We want to be comfortable in church. We want comfortable chairs. We want the air condition just right. We want the heat just right. We want things, we want it our way. This ain't Burger King. We should want things in our life God's way. Think about it. But we've become selfie-centered. So how do we know that we're living in the last days and we are self-centered? Here's the big one. And if this happened a while ago, shame on you. Number one, I want to use that word. That's my new word. That's mine. Nobody else's trademark, Jonathan Casstevens. Selfie-centered. That's mine. Trademark 2021. If you want to use it, say my pastor's word. Number one, how do I know I'm selfie-centered? You get easily offended. Think about it. You get easily offended. I'm going to tell you, it's just like, for example, I love this one. And how many of us have ever heard this, especially in the City of Refuge? God sent me here. Until you get easily offended. Yes. Amen. Amen? But you know you're a selfie-centered person. In the last days, perilous times shall come, men shall be lovers of themselves. You get easily offended. You think, and I hate to say this, but a person that feels like they get easily offended walks around all the time waiting to get easily offended because they carry the victim mentality. They are always waiting for you to offend them. People that come to this church. Guys, I'm a pretty realist. I tell you what God says about this vision. I tell you what God wants in this church. I tell you what God wants 5 years from now. Anybody that knows me, if you know me as your pastor, you know my heart and you know what I want. Because that's just who I am. But we easily get offended. Catch this. When someone offends you, it should function. When someone offends you, it should throw up a red flag. See, I believe we get offended for one of two reasons. Discontent in ourselves or pride. Yeah, oh, come on, y'all name me discontent. Yeah. When you don't have faith in yourself, yes. when you are someone that battles low self-esteem, why? Because the Bible said you were uniquely and wonderfully made. The Word of God said you were made in the image of God. Come on now, church. But I don't like what I look like. Oh, blame God. Come on now. Why I'm heavy set. At least you got some meat on your bones. While them other folks are freezing when it gets colder, you'll still be snuggled up in insulation. But the thing is, you need to understand that you are who you are. Stop trying to be somebody that you're not. My gosh, don't try to fake it till you make it. Just say, I am who I am. If you don't like me, bite me. I'm not self-centered, but I don't have time to please people. The Bible said, who's it better to please, God or man? But see, you always are discontent. You're never happy. Have you ever seen someone that is never happy? Those people, and how many of you know, they'll let you know they're not happy. They'll swell up and puff up and they'll do all these things. Well, Pastor hurt my feelings. Guys, how? The only time I really ever talk, and y'all know this, is when I'm preaching, sharing things. I'm a pretty private person. You'll never hear somebody, if somebody tells you, I said, come to the man. I'll shoot you straight. You might not like it. Well, why did so-and-so leave? This is not American Idol. This is not Days of Our Lives. Amen. This is the house of God. People, I'm going to tell you something. Once again, if we want our church to be what God wants it to be, there has to be a proven time. There has to be a time. Yeah, I would love to ordain Brother Jeremy right now as an elder, but there's a proven time. He's in the fourth month of his triumph period. Brother Bo's the same way. But one thing I can tell you, these men have stood faithful. I mean, Jeremy done told Stephanie that she needs to make $60,000 a year. It ain't changed. And raise her hand when she wants to talk. But think about it. But think about it. A selfie culture, catch this. A selfie culture breeds a defensive posture. Defensive. I'm going to tell you, the best way to keep yourself out of turmoil is to keep your mouth shut. Let the Lord fight the battle. Because the Bible said, vengeance is mine, thus saith the Lord. I will repay. But when we speak, the Bible says to be swift to hear, slow to speak. Well, Pastor, they were talking about you. I'm sure they did last night. Praise Jesus. I have my little grandson. My little Carter was with me yesterday. We had a good time. The kids had a good time with him. My boy showed up. And the thing was, the thing that gets me all the time is woe unto the person everyone speaks well of. Because usually they're wolves in sheep's clothing. But we have a problem where we want to attack when God said in his word, I'll go before you. He said what, church? When you go through the desert, you will not be burnt. When you go through the flood, you will not drown. For I, the Lord thy God, am with you everywhere you go. But while we're, I don't know why I'm saying this, you feel the Holy Spirit telling it. But while we're trying to fight the battle, Jesus, God's sitting on the sideline saying, when you get through making a butt of yourself, I'll step in, take care of it. But self-centered people are always on the defensive. When they came to, when Jesus was brought before them and said, are you the king of the Jews? What did he say? You said I am. Come on, you with me? You said I was. You said it, I didn't. See, catch this. When someone attacks our self-worth, we get defensive. I don't care what people think I am. In God, I know who I am. So what? I've been so poor I couldn't rub two pennies together to get 5 cents. So what? I had a previous marriage. So what? Well, so-and-so said this about you. So what? As long as they're talking about me, they're giving you a break. So thank God when they're talking about your pastor. Oh, they're going to keep off me for about 5 minutes. Hallelujah. See, if it's true, Christians should take notice when they get offended. Having worked in Christian ministry for the years I have, the most defensive group of people I've ever been around are so-called Christians. And everybody in this house can say amen. They are so offended. Well, I'll tell you what, that church that y'all got over there, they play that contemporary junk. I ain't coming. We didn't invite you. Okay? We already knew you didn't like it. If you don't like it, stay off our YouTube channel and get your own. Well, I don't like that pastor. He don't wear a suit. Okay, don't watch. See, the problem is, they get so defensive. Well, that church over there is going to hell because they have a Christian rock service called Saturday Night Live. What church in this area has something like that? City of Refuge does. Why do they do that? Those kids need to hear the word of God. Have you listened to the words? No, you listen to the beat. Yes, amen. Go ahead. We get so defensive. We didn't ask you to show up. Amen. I come because I'm the pastor. And because I want to hear these young people teach. Now, I don't know half the time what that music's saying. But when I see those kids enjoying it, I'm like, okay. I mean, Bo could put it on the screen, but it'd catch on fire because the music's so quick. It'd be like he'd burn out the TV screen. It's so hot. But the thing is me and Heather were talking, was talking to some folks Wednesday night. The older group of teens are getting ready to separate themselves from the other teens, and that way we can have three youth groups, because this older generation, we're going to separate them. They're young men and young women. I mean, you should get excited that we have three different sets of youth now. But see, catch this. It's strange, really. If you follow Jesus, you should be a fish swimming upstream. A counterculture model, which is our world, needs desperately Christians that don't get offended. Come on. See, Christians are more sensitive, and some of you in this house are guilty of this. You're more sensitive to others' remarks than most non-Christians, because you get so easily offended. But the sad thing is, somebody in your life taught you to be that way. And 9 times out of 10, it could have been a pastor. And one person said, amen. But can I tell you something? The way y'all live y'all's life is a byproduct of what I teach you. Come on. Well, pastor, I don't want to bring no shame to you. You won't if you walk in the Spirit. It's when you start doing things of the flesh. When you leave today, you're walking out of City of Refuge, and you are showing the church, showing the world what City of Refuge is all about. Come on now. Matter of fact, I tell people all the time, when people tell me they go to such and such church, my second question is why? Why do you go there? Here's the most popular question on the board. My family does. Why does your family go there? Next one on the board, because their family goes there. And their family goes there. Why do you sit on that bench? Granny did. There'll never be benches in City of Refuge. So if you pass away, we won't put little thing on there saying you used to sit there. We'll just say they used to sit there. Now that chair's up. But have you ever seen that? By a stained glass window in the church in memory of somebody. Stained glass. How about feed the homeless in memory of somebody? Come on. I went by, I know it sounds crazy, but last week I went by the cemetery over there where Granny and Mom's buried. And I was just sitting there, and I was just looking. And I was looking at how many people. I remember the first person, L.D. Anderson. And slowly but surely, the older generation is leaving. My question to you is, what kind of legacy are you going to leave when you leave? See, think about this. But we get easily offended. Jesus was never offended. Oh, come on, church. And to be a Christian is to be Christ-like. See, Jesus never got offended. You won't find Jesus saying, I thought this was pretty cool when God gave it to me, I can't believe that Pharisee called me a heretic. Now, boy, that sounded funny coming out of Jesus' mouth, didn't it? But you're a Christian. It shouldn't come out of you. I can't believe so-and-so is talking about me. I am so offended. When I see, I'll slap them in the mouth. There you go. Neither give place to the devil. If I ever see them again, I ain't so sure I won't think like I pass out and run over them. But see, this is the things that come out of our mouth. But Jesus never said, I can't believe those Pharisees are calling me that. Now think about what I just said, and you laughed. Jesus may have said, can you believe that John? Can you believe that John? That's how I put it. Can you believe that John? He's ugly and stupid. Come on now, did you catch what I just said? You never heard John talking to, or God, or Jesus talking to Matthew about John. Oh, come on, it's tight, but it's right. Jesus was never self-centered. It wasn't about him. Jesus said in his word, when people were healed, he didn't say, it was me that did it. He said, your faith has made you whole. He said, go tell no one of what I've done, but that when you do talk about it, give glory to the Father. But when we do things in church, we want everybody to see it. Those people that work behind the scenes. And I use this young man in our sound room. He's never asked me to talk to y'all about what he does. Our church would be lost if it wasn't for the things that he does. But you don't never hear nothing from Bo. I tell him to get a whistle if he catches on fire in there. Let me know he's there. But see, think about this. Jesus was never offended because he was humble. Self-centered people are not humble. Self-centered people can't be taught. Self-centered people always, I'm going to tell you something. When they get to the end of life's journey, and here's how serious that is. If you'd have told that young girl, Nora Smitherman, last weekend, that she would have died at a party because of a gun accidentally misfiring, she'd have said no. See, we are not promised our next breath, our next meal, our next day. God said, worry about now. Because today's the day of salvation. It's a scripture that we use a whole lot. See, when you're humble, now I want you to write this down. Humility is the antidote of defensiveness. Humility is the antidote for defensiveness. Now, think about that. Humility. Who cares? The Bible even tells us this, does it not? Who's it better to please, God or man? Man can kill you, but they can't take your salvation. Man can kill you, but they can't take your relationship with God. See, think about this. Humility doesn't allow you to elevate yourself too high. Humility. Jesus walked on the water, but yet he washed the feet of his disciples. He raised Lazarus from the dead, but yet when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, and his sweat became as great drops of blood, when they were beating him, when they were mocking him, when they were doing all the things, Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When he was on the cross, and the thieves were making fun of him, and the one thief said, will you remember me when you get into your kingdom? He said, today thou shalt be with me when I go into paradise. The thing that we must understand, think about the hurt Jesus experienced when the folks that he had healed, the folks he had fed, the folks that had walked with him were in the crowd of people saying, crucify him. Jairus' daughter could have been there. But Jesus looked at them with compassion. Matter of fact, did he not say in one scripture there he had compassion upon them because they were sheep with no shepherd? Think about it. Humility forces you to consider other people before yourself. If you're a Christian, and this is what God gave me, it's time to stop getting offended. Get off your high horse and start thinking about others. Here's another, and I want to read the scripture. Brother Bo, I want to use this scripture. If you will, go to Philippians 2 and 3 real quick. Philippians 2 and 3 says this, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Now, what is this? And I'm going to tell you something. We might be guilty of this one. Number two, and I'm just going to go through a few. You have a never enough mindset. You have a never enough mindset. Mindset. What did the Word of God tell us? But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Here's the problem. We don't seek God and his righteousness. We have a never enough mindset. There are people that, how many of you know people like this? Their house is big enough, but not big enough for them. Come on now. You know what I'm saying? They have and the thing is, you're sitting there saying, boy, if I had that house right there. But we live in a lot, we have people that are selfie-centered, and they have a never enough mindset. Catch this. And I know this, I know y'all don't like things, don't do these things like I do, and you probably don't even know who this is. But Brené Brown in Daring Greatly said, scarcity breeds a never enough mindset. Scarcity. See, scarcity says, catch this, that you're lacking something. Scarcity says you're not pretty enough. Scarcity says you're not successful enough. You aren't smart enough. And then we can go on and on and on. See, the thing is, I'm going to say this today under the direction of the Holy Spirit. Kids that live in poverty never feel like they have enough. Come on. See, what is the result of people that have a never enough mindset? Selfie-centered Christians are tight-fisted with everything. I'm talking about the Christians. I ain't talking about the sinners. They're tight-fisted. If you've ever made this statement, shame on you. They deserve what they're getting. You deserve hell. But because of the gift of salvation, you're not going. Well, he deserves to lose his family. He's a drug addict. He's an alcoholic. How many times you've been on the brink of divorce? Come on now. Well, you know, he deserves to go to prison. Really? No, the problem is, here's the thing. People, and I know, I don't care if we get down to one subscriber, but the thing is, people that are so easy to pass condemnation on people are people that are hiding things in their own closet. Theirs got exposed and yours hadn't. You just ain't got caught yet. But yours is coming. Well, they deserve everything they're getting. No. Now catch this. See, they're tight-fisted from everything, from praise to their pocketbook. When's the last time you really praised God? When's the last time you praised yourself out of a situation? When's the last time where God turned something around just because you gave him the sacrifice of praise? And Christians are tight-fisted with their pocketbooks. I think it's funny. I think it's really funny when I hear people say, I trust God. You do when it's things that you can see. It's those things you can't see. That's when you trust God. Well, so-and-so in my family is going to court in the next couple of weeks. God goes before them. Well, so-and-so in my family is getting ready. They got a baby. It's getting ready to be born. And they said there's things going to be wrong with it. God's done gone before you. Go ahead. See, that's the thing. You may be sitting here this morning saying, how's it going to work out? Don't try to make it work out. Just let God work it out. Just let God say, because you see, you have a never enough mindset. If God wants you to have it and you trust him, you're going to have it. Because if God wants it done, there ain't enough devils in hell can stop something that God wants to do. The only person that can stop what God wants to do in your life is you. The only person that can stop God from making a way where there seems to be no way in your life is you. When the woman said, when she said, I want to be made whole, he said, thy faith has made thee whole. See, the thing is you have a never enough. Okay, for example, you want a beautiful house, but you don't want to trust God. Come on now. See, the thing is this. They are plagued. These are selfie-centered Christians. They are plagued by discontent, shame, and here's a word you don't never hear me say, disengagement. Selfie-centered Christians with a never enough mindset, they're the type of people that separate themselves from everybody. Well, I went to that church and, you know, nobody spoke to me. Did you speak to them? Amen. Was so-and-so mad at me? They didn't talk to me. Did you make a point to say hey to them?
That's right. Go ahead.
You don't know what somebody had to go through to get here this morning. Maybe they got a word on the way in that something was going on in their family and they had to leave right after service. You don't know. But your victim mentality makes you think everybody's mad at you. See, here's the most toxic part of a self-centered Christian. Now catch this. Here's the most toxic part, though, of self-centered Christians. They believe the answer to their never enough problem is abundance. Can I ask you a question? How many cars can you drive at one time? Well, if you can't, you can, but you'd get caught. But the thing is, how many cars can you drive at one time? One. Why do you need eight? Come on now, church. How many houses can you live in? One. Why do you need three? I think you're missing what I'm saying. You already got abundance. You just want an overflow. Come on now. If I lose weight, I will be enough. If I buy a new car, I will be happy. If I become CEO, I will be content. Guys, I'm going to tell you something. The higher you go up the ladder in your profession, the harder it gets. And they're going to pay you because where much is given, much is required. See, that's the problem that we have. Everybody wants the abundance, but nobody wants to put in the work. If I lose weight, I'll be happy. Treadmill down to Elk and Rec. Me? Not so much. It's Sunday. I'm tired. I'm going home. Get me something to eat, put my pajamas on, and set my recliner and watch TV. And you know what? This thing might be strong, but it ain't because I'm texting. It's because I'm checking the TV channels. I deserve that when you work 6 or 7 days a week. Think about it. The opposite of never enough is an abundance. You know what it is? Contentment. What was the scripture I gave y'all that God gave me this first of this year? In whatever state I'm in, I'm content. See, the contentment is the opposite of never enough. I'm content. You know what? Got a roof over my head, shoes and clothes on my children's feet, the power's on, I didn't get cold last night, my baby slept. I'm content. But while we're trying to outdo other people, people are dying and going to hell.
Yes, yes. Go ahead.
But we're not content. Well, I hear this all the time. I need to go to the gym. I need to work out more. I need to lose weight. But yet they don't spend time in the Word of God to get stronger in faith.
Go ahead.
Vanity.
Yeah.
The Word of God even says that. But see, the opposite of never enough is contentment. Self-centered Christians have a better chance of catching a cheetah at full speed than catching contentment. You miss that. Think about it. I'll say it again. Self-centered Christians have a better chance of catching a cheetah at full speed than catching contentment. You will never catch a cheetah. But self-centered people are always chasing things instead of contentment. When are we going to get to the point that we're happy with just the blessings of God? When are we going to get to the point? I was thinking about this morning. I woke up and I looked outside, and, you know, of course, there's a little bit of frost on the ground. I looked outside and I said, God, thank you. And I heard that little voice of Satan. Why are you thanking him? I said, because it's not going to be cold at the house of God this morning. People ain't going to be freezing to death and sitting out in their cars and listening to us on the radio. Amen. See, content. We're content in this building, but we know something. God's got something greater. And when it's God's timing for another building, it'll just come.
That's right.
We're content.
That's right.
I walked in this morning. As soon as I walked in, I said, man, it sure is warm in here. And then it's like God spoke to me and said, it sure was cold a year ago.
Yes.
You got me, God. You got me. You got me, God. See, so how do we? To combat our scarcity-driven culture, here's how we do it. We must focus, we must fix our eyes on God.
Yes.
See, how many of you know our God is our giver? Come on, you missed that. God gives. How many of you know God, he never lacks?
Yes.
See, he don't just own the cattle on a thousand hill. He owns the hill.
Yes.
Oh, come on, church.
Amen.
Glory to God. Think about this. And when we find, I feel like I need to say this, and please listen to me. When we find our value and worth in God, he'll fill every void.
Yes.
Every insecurity.
Yes.
And every handle, catch this. Every insecurity and hand delivers the contentment we consider so elusive in our life. Please catch that. Stop comparing yourself to other people. I wish I would catch that. It's just like, for example, and I can say this because been there, done that, got the T-shirt. But when you've ever been cheated on, if you're not very careful, and especially if you find out who the person was, you'll start comparing yourself to that person. But you wasn't the one that needed fixing. It was that person that cheated that needed fixing. Okay? Here we go. One more, and we'll land this plane for today. How many of you know people like this? Selfie-centered. How many of you know people that their mood shifts? Mood shifts. I think that's a good one right there. Mood shifts. How do they do it? Positively or negatively? But now here's the big thing, guys. Here it is. See, every one of y'all said that, but you didn't really look at it. Your mood shifts based on the opinion of others. I didn't say PMS. Patsy Marie Smith, poor man syndrome. But your mood shifts. There's everybody in this house. You have made a decision or changed your mood based on what you think other people wanted.
Yeah.
They're not happy in their marriage, so you choose not to be happy in yours. They're not happy in their relationship with God, you choose not to be happy in yours. But see, the problem is your mood shifts positively or negatively based on the opinion of others. How many of you have ever seen people change themselves for the approval of others? They start doing things for the based on the opinion of others. See, selfie-centered Christians allow the opinions of others to determine their self-worth. Their mood shifts, positively or negative. And here's where you catch them, what you catch them doing. As they scan Facebook, as they look on their Twitter or their Instagram. I'm going to tell you something that God showed me 2 weeks ago. Snapchat is very, very good for the spirit of adultery, the spirit of lust. Because I didn't realize this till I think Gracie or somebody told me. Once that post is seen, magically disappears. And don't y'all think that that's the spawn of Satan? Your kid can cuss somebody out on Snapchat, and that other kid come and tell you, and they have no proof. You're missing what I'm saying. Something that can be used positively is negative. See, catch. I'm gonna teach you. Here we go. It got quiet up in here. If the likes trend upward on your, some of you, you want to see who liked your post. Who cares? Well, I'm sure Pastor seen my post. Why didn't he like it? Pastor, don't get on Facebook. Okay? I don't go on that. I don't go, I wonder what Rita put on Facebook today. Guys, I love y'all, but I don't have time to scan it. But you're sitting there saying, I only got 5 likes on that picture. I got 2,000 friends. No, you have 2,000 people accepted your friend request. You take that 2,000, divide it by 1,000, you'll find out who your true friends are. Amen. They're not a dime a dozen. But see, you do that thing. You want to see how many likes you get. Like, for example, I will say this as I put something on Facebook. I did see where Tina was doing this thing about a Duke Santa Claus. She better be glad I did not post anything. Because if it had been a starting bid, I'd said toilet. But see, the thing is, though, I thought about it. He's like, I better not put that on there. Amen. Although I was thinking it. That's right, for Dukies. And by the way, go Heels. We beat Wake Forest yesterday. Undefeated Wake Forest, hallelujah. But think about this. The more likes press upward, you feel better about yourself. Based on what? The approval of others. Where the Bible says, who's it better to please, God or man? I love y'all, but one of the biggest weaknesses a lot of you in this church, and probably on CORCC TV, is you're so focused on what other people think that you're not focused on what God thinks. I love you. But your biggest problem, and I'm talking to City of Refuge, your biggest problem is most of you, you still can't grasp the concept, who cares what people think. Amen. You got to stop. Amen. My gosh. It's just like, for example, if you want to put black mulch all around your house, don't ask me what I think about it. It's your house. Amen. Well, do you think I'll do this? Do you? Why ask me? It's your house. Put a toilet on top of the roof. Your house. Your roof. But here's the problem. We're so worried. I know it gets quiet up in here, and probably people on CORCC TV feels the same way, and that's good. Maybe I'm helping you. But you got to stop. You're more selfie-centered. You either live a positive life or a negative life based on the approval of others. And everybody in this church can say amen because it's the truth. Your mood shifts based on the approval of people who will not stand before you, will not stand for you on the day of judgment. They will not stand before you when, I'm going to tell you something. Tell somebody to help you pay something. And here I'm starting making excuses why they can't. But see, here's your problem. And I know this because I'm talking to City of Refuge. You have mood shifts. Well, that hurt my feelings. Walking in the spirit, you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. We don't walk by sight as Christians. We walk by faith. Come on, church. But see, the thing is, selfie-centered Christians feel better about themselves with the approval of people. Boy, that's selfie-centered. That's a good one. But think about this. However, catch this. If, however, their latest pick they spend only 30 minutes filtering doesn't receive any love, they have a feeling of shame and unworthiness. Who cares if nobody else liked your outfit you're wearing? Did they pay for it? I bought a new outfit. What y'all think? Why did you even give place to the devil? If you feel good, if you want so much makeup on you that you look like Tammy Faye back in the day, putty it on, baby, and don't worry about the approval of others. If you want to tattoo your face and your feet and your legs and your whole body and it makes you feel good and somebody else don't like it, it wasn't their money. Do it. Who cares? God wants us to live our life not for the approval of others, but for the approval of God. And if he wants, if it makes us feel good, you know it's got to make him feel good. See, y'all, I done lost some people. Who's Tammy Faye? Oh, it's shame of y'all not know who Tammy Faye was. If you ain't never, you don't know Tammy Faye, Google. She would put enough, if you think Dolly Parton was fake, there was Tammy Faye back in the day before there was DP and breast implants. Hallelujah. But the thing is this. If it makes you feel good, why do you need the approval? When I bought my truck, if you don't like the color, you didn't pay for it. I seen the perfect thing the other day. And I can't remember. I think it was one of my pastor friends was in front of this church. And I looked past him. I didn't even listen to him. I looked at lime green and purple church. I was like, whew, yes, sir. There it is. Well, I don't like that color. You need to go to that brick church down the road then. Mm-hmm, catch it. But see, the thing is, let me say this. When I started doing Facebook Lives back when, during the pandemic, I can honestly tell each and every one of you, I wasn't ready for the attacks that I got. I got plenty of attacks. But see, I just love talking about God. I love talking about what God's doing in our church. I love talking about what we did last Saturday night. But see, but the thing was, it wasn't long before negativity knocked on my door. Anytime you're doing something great for God, you can expect a knock on the door of negativity. You're going to have somebody that's not, there's going to be somebody that's not going to like the way we do our Christmas program. So what? You don't go to church here. You don't like the way we celebrate Halloween. Who cares? You don't go to church here. If y'all expected everybody to love what we do at this church, y'all out of your ever-loving mind. People, I got a comment because I wore a cap Wednesday in the pulpit. You know what I said? Wait till I wear the next one next Wednesday night. I'll wear a cowboy hat. I don't, you know, whatever. It just, everybody, my haters are my motivators, guys. I'm sorry. If they ain't sure, shame on you. But my haters are my motivators. When people say something, I'm like, oh, God, just give me more fuel. I just need say something else. Just do it. Don't even get me started. But I would. But, Pastor, you're making them mad. No, I'm not. I'm just giving them what they wanted. See, but the thing is, I knew it was coming. And let me say this right here, and I got to write this down. Negativity comes in packs. Negativity comes in packs. Now, catch what I just said. You're going to have not one person, because somebody's got to have somebody else to help them. They need a culprit. That's exactly right. But negativity comes in packs. Now catch that. Eventually, if you're not careful, negativity will bust through the door and into your heart. Oh, come on, church. I'm trying to help you. I told you, we're no longer on the milk of this word. It's time for the meat. We've had people hungry, and we've been giving them appetizers. Now we're getting ready to go for a meal. But the thing is this, negativity will break through the door and into your heart. Because what does the Bible say? As a man or woman thinketh, so are they. See, negativity just needs a place to camp. And then negativity, when it comes through in your life, and negativity is sin. Because we don't serve a negative God. And sin, when it's finished, brings forth death. Most people that commit suicide, they did it based on the negativity of others. Their self-worth was being based on what people thought than what God thought. When you look at a suicide note of a 30-year-old man, and you read that his self-worth was based on the approval of other people, all it took was one for me when I lost that one. But negativity comes in packs. And most of the time, whether you want to admit it or not, that negativity comes from people that you call family. That negativity comes from people you call friends. That negativity comes from people that you used to have faith in. But see, the thing is, and here's what happens when negativity busts through the door. You ready? You doubt your gifts. Did God really give me that vision for the Christmas program? Did God really give Pastor the vision for the gathering? God, how we, I mean, I ain't going to sit here and tell y'all I haven't said this to God. God, how's it going to work this year? Because, you know, everybody, the five or six places we had 2 years ago is closed down. God, how are we going to do it? And he said, if it's my will, it's my bill. I said, okay, God, that's all I need to hear. God, how are we going to take a bunch of folk that have been beaten down, busted, and disgusted throughout all their life, and we're going to teach them to live positive? It's my will, my bill. How many of you know, if you see your pastor being blessed, I'm the head. And if God's blessing me, open up and say, ah, because he's going to bless you. When God gave Heather and I a new house, how many of you sat in new houses today that God gave you this year after God blessed the man of God? You with me? But as your faith, so shall it be unto you. Now catch this. I know I got to go. And here's what happens when negativity busts through the door and into your heart. You begin to resent people. Including those that are the closest to you. Because you let negativity bust through the door. When the Word of God says to let the Holy Spirit take care of the door. I love y'all, but here's what the Holy Spirit spoke to me this morning about 3:30. Some of you are still, and I hate to say this, and I wish I could do a better diagram, but I'm not going to attempt it. You still have open doors to your past. You say that you're freed from your past, but when people talk about it, it still hurts, then you're not healed. Being healed says they can talk about it, but it don't hurt anymore. But, Pastor, you don't understand. I don't have to understand. It's not my job to understand. It's up to you to allow the Holy Spirit to close that door and seal it. But here's the problem. I'm terrible with diagrams. This is the door. This is the door. This is the door. This is the door. What happens when this door is not sealed by the Holy Spirit? When you get hurt here, you fall back into this door. Then something happens. You go back to this door. Then you get hurt again. You go back to this door. And the reason why you went back to all these doors is because it wasn't sealed with the Holy Spirit. You can let the doors of your past be a testimony, or you can let the doors of your past be a crutch. Some people choose to let it be a crutch. They choose to let it be a crutch because they don't. They can say they want to heal, but they don't want to do what it takes to be healed. Like the doctor, you can go to the doctor, and the doctor can tell you what you need to take to get well. He can send the prescription in, but it's up to you to go pick it up. Oh, boy, I felt that slap me back in the face. I don't know if that was CRCC TV or y'all, but that's the problem. There it was. You got to put some shoes on your faith. You got to put effort on your production. I can tell you, that's what people get mad at me about. I can tell you what it takes to get there, but you got to do it. I ain't got time to take you to it. Well, Pastor, I'm tired of getting losers as boyfriends. Well, why in the world are you still on that dating app? Well, Pastor, I'm tired of losers. Then why are you searching for them in the bar? And why don't you start looking for them in the house of God? Well, Pastor, I'm tired of it. Same spirit, different face. That's because you keep choosing the wrong one. Because the Bible says, let God show you. Let your steps be ordered by Him. And I got to say this under the direction of the Holy Spirit. When God's done working on you, if that's the person for your life, God will be done working on them. And whenever He gets done working on them, gets done working on you, they'll put you two together. Come on now. I think it's funny. There was a friend of mine. Now, I don't know dating apps. I don't even know why I even said a dating app. I don't know why I said it. But there was a friend of mine, so they went on this thing called plentyoffish.com. If there's plenty of fish, there ain't enough fishermen. Am I right, Jeremy? I don't know how it works. But, I mean, and the thing is, have you ever, okay, I don't know why I'm here, but it sounds good. But have you ever seen a picture of a stud? You go meet them at the restaurant, they're a dud? Come on, have you ever been there, done that, got a T-shirt? Never have gone on a dating app. Too much work. But the thing is this. How many of you ever heard that song? Who sings it? Looking for love in all the wrong places. Some of you doing that. Who sung it? Was that Waylon? Charlie Pride. There we go, there we go. Well, Charlie could sing back in the day. But how many of you know the thing is how many of you... I feel this in my spirit, too. Just because it's delayed doesn't mean it's been denied. Y'all miss that. Just because it ain't here now don't mean it's not going to show up. See, oh, Jesus. There is always a delay. Okay, I got to show you. Here's the promise. Then there's a delay, and that equals the fulfillment. See, here's the thing. Why is it delayed? Your faith, but also God's got to see that you're faithful. See, everybody, I hear this, I had this guy come up to me this week. Brother, when are you going to have me come preach at your church? I'm not. He said, I thought you loved me. I do love you, but... Your meat's not for my house. And first off, if God wants you to come to this house, He'll speak to me. You won't have to ask me. This one gospel group, this guy says, when God leads you in the Spirit for us to come and sing at your church, let me know. I put on there, sorry, your music's not for our church. Didn't want to hurt his feelings, he asked. We're not Southern gospel. That's just not us. Because I'd have some of y'all like, what in the world's wrong with Pastor? Okay? But here's why it's delayed. There is always a delay to the fulfillment to test everything you know about God. What if God would have gave us the building to house everything for our church and not put us in this small one? You wouldn't be thankful. Some of y'all, and I love you, you should have got up this morning and thank God we're not having church at the park. Okay? But the delay is for God to test you and for you to trust Him. Amen. Catch that? Yep. See, here's the problem. I feel this in my spirit. I don't know why the Holy Spirit's going to go here, but you that are single, If you have to change yourself for the approval of the other person, they're not for you. If you was on fire for God before they met you, you should be more on fire for God now that they met you. You shouldn't be falling back, because here's the problem. You were reading the Word of God. Oh, God, I'm just being obedient. You were reading the Word of God. You was praying. You were listening to your music, your gospel music, and then you met this person. You stopped reading. You stopped praying. You stopped listening, and you've conformed yourself to what they want instead of them being conformed to what God wants. I know I'm preaching better than you're shouting, but glory to God, you've changed. If you have to change for the worst, they're not for the better. Come on now. If you have to change who you are, that's a miserable life. If anybody in this house ever tried to do it, I did. It don't work. God, it don't work. God, it don't work. Jesus, take the will. It don't work. First church I pastored, they wanted me to wear a suit. They wanted me to wear khakis and a polo every Wednesday night. Whew. I looked at myself. That was when I was 20 years old. I looked at myself, Sister Stephanie. I still got that picture. I was not happy because I was not Jonathan. But now when I look on CORCC TV and I watch it, I watch every service. First off, I want to see how the praise team's doing. I want to see if they're praising or they're not. And then I want to look at my message and I want to say, okay, now, I should have hit that harder. Does that make sense? Anybody ever done that? Or maybe you do. I don't know if y'all have to do these, but we have to do IDG notes. And what they call it, IDT, IDG, or whatever. There's different slang, but it's the teams get together. And when I send my notes in every other week, I'll look at it, then I'll send it, and then I still got a little delay in there between the day I sent it to the day if I need to edit it. And then I'll look, I should have said this. Pastor, why do you watch it? It's not that I'm conceited. I want to be better. Yeah. Amen. I don't want to be just a pastor. I want to be the best pastor. Amen. And I can't be the best pastor trying to please people. Amen. I can't be a pastor that, I say this, and I know this sounds crazy, but I can't be close to Juanita and not be close to Sister Rita.
That's right.
You can't have best friends in the church.
Amen.
I am the pastor. And as the pastor, there's things I can't do. It ain't that I don't love you. It's just I don't want people to think I play favoritism. I've been in churches like that, and I have had my feelings hurt. That ain't happening here. If you've had your feelings hurt too, why's pastor go out to eat with this family, but I've asked him to come and eat with me for 6 months? Does he think we nasty?
Go ahead, you're right.
Well, if pastor didn't go out with that family, he'd have never had to worry about it.
Right.
Does that make sense? Am I helping you?
Yeah.
See? Mood shifts. But catch this. And then the people that you resent the most are the people that's closest to you. See, the biggest problem is we're not able to differentiate between destructive criticism and constructive criticism. Because, think about what I'm saying. See, people, here's the thing. When I tell you what you're doing's wrong, it's constructive. But if you still have mood shifts, you feel like it's destructive. Well, why don't pastor want me to be happy? He keeps saying the guys and girls that I'm dating ain't good for me. I never said that. If it popped in your mind, you thinking it. I'm just planting a seed. Come on, are you with me? Well, pastor must think this. No, see, that's what you think. But that's because your mood shifts. See, think about it. When you think everybody's out to get you, you won't trust people that's really there for you. I'm here for you. I'm not your other pastor. I'm not a pastor that takes what I do lightly. I'm not a pastor that just says, okay, I think I'll preach a message to hurt them this morning. I know pastors like that. They got the little stooge that's out in the congregation trying to find out all the 411 on people. And then they're going to take what that person is doing and they're going to get in the pulpit and read, well, maybe not even read the Bible, But then they're going to get up there and they're going to bash that person. Everybody knows who they're talking about.
Yep, you're right.
Am I telling the truth? They got a stooge. Pastor, why do you go in that room with Bo all the time? I don't need to hear what's going on in everybody's life before getting the pulpit. I don't. And when service is over, I'm usually in the build, in the room. Not because I don't want to say hey to everybody. It's just, y'all are adults. You don't wear diapers, I hope, yet. And you don't need bottles. You're adults. And if you always trust me, you're never going to trust yourself. I want you to trust me as your pastor. But I want you to walk. I want you, when you walk out the doors of this church and something comes against you this week, I want you to say, Pastor gave me that one. I know what's coming.
That's right.
But the thing is this. When you're constantly in mood shifts, it's a lose-lose race. Think about what I'm saying. The only competitor in your life, here's your competition. Your competition is you. You're always competing against yourself. Why didn't I get that promotion? Maybe God knew you didn't need it. Maybe God knew you wasn't ready for it. Think about it. Your competition is you. See, you're the greatest threat to your greatness. I've been writing a book. Heather don't even know about it. But I've been writing a book now for 3 months. If I've got 15 or 20 minutes and I ain't got nothing going on, I got this book in my car. And as I'm writing this book, the title of it's The Journey. See, I know what it's like to try to please others. And I know what it's like to try to be somebody I'm not. And that's exhausting. See, the thing is this. You're the greatest threat to your greatness. Don't run from pain. Come on. How many of you know growth is a process? They say that kids, when they're transforming from babies to kids, they experience something called growing pains. But see, don't run from the pain. Let me say this with you. The path to joy is often messy and painful. Difficult conversations. There ain't nothing harder to swallow than to have your spiritual father look at you and say, you missed it. How many of you know that? And see, if you don't walk in the spirit, you'll take that as destructive criticism, not constructive criticism. When your boss walks up to you and helps you, I feel this in my spirit, I'm almost done. When your boss walks up to you and says, you don't need to be doing it that way, don't take it as destructive. Take it as constructive. Come on. Now, if you're still doing it 2 or 3 years down the road, they need to fire you.
Amen.
They need to fire you because they've already told you in a nice way.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
Difficult conversations. And something else I want y'all to catch, if you don't learn nothing else from me today, own up to your bad decisions. Stop blaming everybody else for the decision you made. It ain't their fault you screwed up. It ain't their fault. Biggest one's this one. I quit going to church because somebody hurt my feelings. Own up that you're still not mature. Own up that you're still wanting to be petty. You're still wanting to be childish. You're still wanting to play the victim. How many times have you been around people that something happened in their life 20 years ago and they're still throwing the victim card? When I was a child, I spake as a child. I did things as a child. But when I became a man or woman, I put away the childish things. Sooner or later, you got to get rid of the victim and start being the victor. God, I don't know where that came from, but it's good. But when you run from the hard stuff Oh, hallelujah. This right here lines up with what I just said, and I'm done. When you run from the hard stuff, you'll also run from the good stuff. How many of you ever went through something and at the end of that thing said, boy, I tell you what, it was worth it right there. Uh-huh. But when you run from the hard stuff, I want to write that down. We're done. When you run from the hard stuff, when you run from the hard stuff, you run from the good stuff. I want to ask you a question. How many of you have ever put, and I'm landing the plane right now. How many of you have ever put a lot of sweat equity into something? You ever busted your finger with a hammer, cut yourself with a knife while you're cooking the food, and you have the battle scars, but boy, sure wasn't it sure good after you got done with it. Like, for example, when Heather makes certain meals, and she's got the whole kitchen full of stuff, and you're sitting there, that right there has to go into that, and that has to go into that. But then when she's done, boy, isn't that thing good. See, the thing is, here's the problem. 99.9999999% of the time, when you're running away from something bad, you run away from what is good. Because it's good. When Satan tells you to run away, like for example, I know we've had folks that have left our church for whatever reason, and they ran away. And they said that this was the perfect church. It wasn't the church that ran them away. It was them that ran them away. Because they were looking for a reason to run away. How many of you know that to be true? Our church is the perfect church for non-perfect people. But non-perfect people want to strive to get toward being perfect. I'll never be perfect. I never said you was going to be. But the Word of God tells us to strive to be. We miss that. But this morning, I want to thank everybody for joining us on CORCC TV this morning. Join us again Wednesday night a couple hours after our service. Thank you for joining us. We'll talk to you soon. God bless.